Hi.
Would you please tell me who you are?
My name is Theresa Anderson. Everyone has called me Tree since I can remember.
And what are you doing at ArtPrize?
I'm showing a painting at ArtPrize over at Rockwell Republic that is a new form of art that I just kind of discovered about 6 months ago, and I'm very excited about it.
So tell me about how you feel your art has evolved throughout your life.
That's a very, very long answer.
We have time.
Okay, let's see, where did we start? I was never intending on doing fine art. I used to work in theatre and film. I went to college to do a degree in stage management and technical theatre because I used to work for a quite famous person as a nanny, and they encouraged me to go to drama school. And I went to drama school, and then after drama school, I really, really lost a lot of money doing a lot of internships for free. Worked on some big films, worked in the West End, in London, and kind of gained a whole bunch of skills that they're not very transferable. So, yeah, I went and joined the circus.
As you do.
Did that for a while. Took pictures on the way. Did photography for a lot of people. Did set design, props design, used art that way. Then, this is a very, very nutshell version. Got injured, couldn't do that anymore. Came off tour, started doing graphics design, and then just recently I'm trying to use all of those skills from all of those things to recreate this new version of me that is using all of that in art. Does that make any sense?
Yes.
Okay. It's a really long-winded story.
So right now you're working with acrylic and resin and fluid art.
Yes.
But before you used to do other mediums.
Yes.
What other medium do you feel that you've worked in that is the most different from what you're doing now?
Pointillism. I used to do very, very detailed representations of photographs with thousands and thousands and thousands of dots, which is completely opposite to what I do now, which is involving throwing around many large quantities of paint. It's possibly the furthest away from where you can get with the two things. One was very small, this is very big. I guess that's about it. Also maybe scenic painting, because that's really big and involves cranes and lifts and spray guns and stuff. And so maybe that too.
Do you feel like the kind of art that you're working with now, when you compare it to something like pointillism seems very, very precise, but do you feel like there's also like this massive amount of precision in what you're doing now, even though it looks less precise to the untrained eye?
I think I paint more now with my whole career, I've been told what to paint. Like, I've always worked for designers. I've been like the realizer of somebody else's vision. And when I was doing pointillism, it was a direct link to that. Like, you have a specific picture that you're looking at, and you are recreating exactly the same thing just in ink and dots. Whereas now, this is a very emotional response to painting. So it's a different type of precision for me. I take weeks and weeks and weeks to think about color choices and how I want to place the paint, but in the end, it really does come down to an emotional response of like a, I don't know, like a relationship between what I'm feeling and what goes down on the canvas. And that's a really new thing for me, because I've never had the option to work from a place that's also incredibly terrifying. Because when someone else is telling you what to do, I have a really great career of recreating all sorts of things for people, and I'm really good at that, and I know I was good at that, whereas this is terrifying. To put something on a wall somewhere that's actually come from a place inside you that is, you know, personal, and then have people critique it is possibly the scariest thing I've done in my career right now, which is crazy, because I know that tens of millions of people have seen things that I've made.
Right.
And this is worse.
What is so the series that you've been working on, you've been working on it for about 6 months, in general. Do you have some of those pieces that you did in the beginning when you were still learning this that you feel are just like
craft projects.
I wasn't going there, but like, do you have pieces that you feel like you just absolutely created something and you have no idea how you did it and you could never do it again, but it was amazing?
Yeah, I've got a couple that I've kept that I'm not going to sell, and I think it's the first time that I realized that I could actually, having an artistic block for years is how I felt I was working. I was good at what I did. People paid me to do it, but there was never any emotional attachment to it. And actually creating something the first time that I went, and the first time that someone said, that's really great, and it was something that had come from a place of, you know, an emotional response, was a big thing. Yeah, I won't be selling those. And they're tiny too. They're like this big.
Yeah. Plenty of room for storage.
Right, yeah. In my nice new art studio that I just built.
Tell me about your art studio.
It's a shed. So, we live in a falling down 1850s farmhouse that is my dream house, and it's going to take me 20 years to restore it, and I love it. And at the end of the garden, there is a carriage house, which is falling down, and I ripped the inside out, and for the first time in my life, I have my very own art studio. And that is where I throw paint around, and no one can tell me to clean up. And there's a lot of paint that gets thrown around in there. And resin, and glitter, occasionally.
Occasionally glitter.
Occasionally glitter. Because why not, right?
Why not glitter? So you just got this house because you moved here a couple of years ago.
Yep.
Tell me about why you picked moving to Grand Rapids.
Oh, you know the answer to this. I did ArtPrize. The first time I did ArtPrize was 5 years ago. I did it with a very small pointillism picture. We'll get into touring, I'm sure. We're going to get into touring at some point. I had come off tour and I was living in Las Vegas, and I had a baby. I was having a baby, and my husband and I did not want to stay in Las Vegas and raise a child. And because we are very transitional people, we've moved around a lot. We came for ArtPrize 5 years ago. I like art, he likes beer, so we moved here. That's pretty much how it went. So I live in Grand Rapids because of ArtPrize.
So right now, it's this very cyclical thing. Like, this is a kind of like a five-year bookend.
Yeah, absolutely. I came here, the piece I put in before, I wasn't particularly attached to. It was an experiment to see how I felt about, you know, putting something into a competition. This whole video thing is massively uncomfortable for me because I'm so used to being a technician. I'm so used to being backstage in the dark, in a workshop somewhere. So right now I'm trying really hard to push myself out of my box. And as you know, this week's been tricky, but we're getting there,
you
right?
Did it great.
So this is kind of
been
like
doing wonderfully.
I don't know. This interview is almost like the end point of actually being on camera and talking about myself without, you know, combusting in flames. Is big deal.
Don't combust into flames. This is a small space.
This is a small space.
We'll ruin their equipment. They'll never have us again.
So yeah, that is how we moved here. Again, that is a part of a bigger conversation, isn't it, about how I ended up in America, really.
Yeah. Do you want to go there?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay.
So I got my degree, and then I went to work in the West End, and I interned on some films, and they were very large films, but I didn't get paid very much, and because I'd come out of university with a lot of student debt, and then I went to intern and was traveling a lot and not making very much money, the debt got bigger. So I chose to, an opportunity came up to, I sent my resume off and I got an interview and was requested to go and see some people, and I ended up working for Cirque du Soleil on their touring shows. And my goal was I could go away for a year, have no bills, no rent, make some money, pay off my student debt, go back to London, live happily ever after. And that was 10 years ago.
Not what happened.
No, that's not what happened. So, I stayed with the tour. It was like a giant, amazing, wonderful family, massively dysfunctional family, but they're wonderful people, and they're all over the world now, and I get to, I pretty much saw most of the world on a touring show, and I kind of like saying I work for the circus because it always catches people off guard. And then I met my husband, and I think if you'd have told me I would have ended up moving to America, that was never my intention. I love it here, but I can't help who you fall in love with, right?
Yeah.
And you know him, so mm-hmm. it was a choice.
Yeah. A good one.
It's a good choice.
It's a good choice.
We're very different. Yeah, and so that's how I ended up here. We came off tour. We went to Vegas because Cirque du Soleil has many shows in Vegas, so we got work in Vegas. And then from there, we came here.
So when you were touring, and you were with this crazy family, and you were, you know, meeting your husband and meeting all these people that have, like, become, like, an extended family all around mm-hmm. the world, even though you were still doing things that were recreating stuff for other people, and you weren't exactly doing your own expressive art, how did you feel about what you were creating as a whole there? Not just, like, the physical prop pieces, but just the whole feeling in general of making that show and doing that tour and...
I was insanely proud of the show, because the standards for Cirque du Soleil are so very, very high. I'm a total perfectionist when it comes to, I can't leave it. Like, mm-hmm. it has to be the very best that I can do, or it's just not worth doing. And so that part of my personality worked really well with the show, because it was beautiful and every single person there was doing exactly the same thing. Like, the work ethic behind creating something so magical when everyone's working for the same goal. Like, you know, the stories from tour, putting tents up in a, you know, tornado season, and there was that whole tsunami, and, you know, I mean, there were some big, big things that happened when we were on tour, and everyone just pitches in. Like, mm-hmm. you don't go home until it's done, and having that kind of work ethic has really set me up, because, it was a beautiful show. I was really proud of that show. All of it. Even the bits, you know, didn't really like doing.
It's kind of, there's a correlation between that, though, because it's like, you... So much of doing those kind of shows is about making something incredibly challenging look effortless.
Yeah, and I mean, if you want to go there, I mean, you look at the acrobats. I mean, yeah. they are superhumans, and they make it look like, you know, who can do a triple back somersault on a pair of stilts off a seesaw? Oh, that person can. You know, if you have any kind of doubt in your talents, don't work with really exceptional humans, because you're just like, oh, yeah, you can. Any kind of self-doubt is massively, yeah. That was kind of hard sometimes, I think, though. To keep that level of perfection up sometimes is, I guess that's what eventually did me in, really. The whole injury thing and having to leave, and which we can talk about. It's not a taboo subject. I'm okay with that.
Go where you want to go.
Yeah, so the reason I now paint the way I do is because I got injured on tour, and I'm unable to use fine motor skills for painting anymore. So after the whole... It's kind of why I explored pointillism too, because I could do such small amounts of work mm-hmm. until... Like, I would work in square inches, maybe one bit a day until the paintings were done. Like, it was a real slow, slow process, but I still had this need to create. And so the whole throwing paint around now and not having to use the fine motor skills of holding a paintbrush or a pair of scissors for long periods of time mm-hmm. has really... I don't know. Painting's like breathing for me, so mm-hmm. for that whole period of time where I couldn't do it anymore, it was really rough.
Yeah.
So this is like, I don't know, it's a new lease of life. And ArtPrize has been brilliant, because I've literally had to put it out there.
Yeah.
I'm like, this is my new thing. This is where I'm going now, so... But, yeah.
I feel like so many people have, like, these really great reactions to your painting and to the kind of art you are doing, because it really does look like it. I've seen you do it. I've seen a time-lapse video of you making a piece, and it's insane the level that you go to and the amount of different steps that are involved, and the blowtorches and straws and tilting of things, and it's just, and cups everywhere, and it's just very
messy.
It's very messy. But at the same time, what you get out of it is something just so intricate and detailed.
And yeah, but you're like my number one fan, so,
well,
you know.
Yeah, but I'm not your only fan.
Well, you are very biased.
I'm one of so very many people.
Well, you're quite biased. It was your idea. It was, you did see that kind of thing and send it to me and say, maybe you should paint like this. And then obviously can't leave it alone and have to throw other things in there. And yeah.
I feel like you're getting a lot better about not fiddling.
I'm not, no.
Okay, well, you're just not telling me about it then.
I just can't. That's why Josh has made me those giant frames.
Mm-hmm.
So I have these big frames in the workshop now with like sheet plastic over it. So I've mentally trained myself that if I'm finished with a painting and I think it's done and then I put the sheet, the plastic and the thing over the top, that's it, it's done. I'm not allowed to go back and touch it again.
So otherwise, do we next need to create like a combination lock situation that only I know the code to?
I don't
know.
They're never done. I don't know if that's an artist thing. Like, you never know when it's done. I don't know. It's a feeling, I guess.
But is that also because, so you have this emotional reaction now, is it also because through the course of painting the piece and creating the piece, your emotions are changing and shifting, and then you feel differently at the end of it than you did when you started it?
No,
and is
I
that
don't
why
think
it's not done?
No, I just
am
think
I reaching
I'm,
there?
I think I'm just a, yeah, I think I just can't help it. And sometimes, you know, if you keep messing with it and then you could ruin the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've done that many. Yeah. The amount of times just scrape it all off and start again. I think that's my obsessive nature though.
What,
am I making myself sound weird, right? I'm like a massively OCD crazy lady.
I think you have to be though, a little bit. I think that's the interesting thing about art and artists is they're also, you know, art is provoking and emotional. You don't, you know, just go to a factory and churn out a piece. That's not, you know, what you do. What you're doing is you're creating something unique and different every time, and it's sometimes you are more OCD about a piece than other times, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that, because all the pieces are different. And it doesn't matter how you arrive at them, or the process, it matters that, you know, you kind of get there in the end.
Yeah, I guess.
And I think that every artist probably feels that way sometimes.
Yeah, it's never done.
But there's other times when I feel like you knock pieces out so quickly. Like with the, oh, that's a good one. Tell me about the Smithsonian.
Oh, that. Yeah. so part of what I create in the studio, I have a small company that I send out vending machine art to. It's a fantastic program. They believe that everyone should be able to own original art. So they create miniatures that you can buy for $5 in a vending machine, and every single one is an original.
Mm-hmm.
And so as part of my process, if I have leftover paint or there's something in my head that I want to try out that I'm not sure if the color combinations are going to work or whatever, I make these little miniatures and use the process to kind of, it's almost like a giant think tank for me to kind of, you know, and if any of them are great, then I wrap them up and I send them over to these people and they put them in vending machines and ship them out. And one of the most exciting things that's happened this week was a one-line email that was very understated that said that they are now stocking my art in the Smithsonian, like the actual Smithsonian. I was like, oh, that's cool. I don't know how long for, but right now...
Does it matter how long for?
No, right now you can go to the Smithsonian and buy a piece of my artwork for $5, which is quite exciting. I don't know. I'm really excited about that.
Someone's going to get a real deal on that,
think?
I think. I do.
Right. I like doing them. I really love the idea that art is for all.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, why should it be thousands and thousands of dollars? You know, unless it's obviously cost that much in materials to make it. You know, it should be accessible. Everybody should have an emotional response. But that's my big thing. It's like, I don't care if you love what I do or you hate it.
Mm-hmm.
I think art's about creating a conversation. And if something could create a conversation and a response in a person, then it's worth doing.
Yeah.
That's probably, yeah. So even if, it's like, you know, orange line on white paper or something, you might think it's the most pointless thing in the world, but somebody did that for a reason.
Mm-hmm.
They had a reasoning behind doing that, and if you hate it and you've told somebody, I hate this, you create a conversation about what you saw. So it's obviously impacted you somehow. So there's got to be merit in that, right?
So what's the most impactful piece of art you've ever seen?
Honestly, the Monets.
Yeah.
look. Mind-blowing. That day that we went to the Arts Institute. Literally, look, I have goosebumps. I I couldn't sleep for days. Like, I literally, remember my badge at the hotel? Mm-hmm. And I just could not stop talking. Mm-hmm. I just, mind-blowing to me how much incredible stuff in one space. It was just amazing. But Monet's there. I just, yeah.
Do you ever think you could do a piece that big?
I would love to have the funds. Somebody needs to sponsor me to have a crack at it.
You'd be doing buckets instead of cups.
That would be amazing, wouldn't it? With rooms and, like, yeah.
How would you even, like, manipulate that? You'd have to, there'd be pulleys involved.
I'd work it out. That would be amazing. Doing something that big.
Goals.
Yeah. You see, my brain started. You'd have to start with it. You couldn't do it on canvas. No. You'd have to be on something else.
Because the resin would make it bow again, right?
Yeah, the resin would be way too heavy. Oh, see, now we're getting all technical. Let's off topic. Yeah.
Kind of on topic.
I guess.
A little bit. I don't know where you'd even put that. It's bigger than your entire studio.
Yeah.
I don't know. The barn.
No, it's really dirty and dusty in there. Yeah. The man shed.
The man shed.
I don't know. What else? Anything?
I don't know. What else do you want to talk about?
I don't know.
What question would you like me to ask you?
Complicated. No, we've covered how I got here. Mm-hmm. What else should we know? I have one sister. She's adorable. I love her. Mm-hmm. My parents are still in England. My whole family is still in England. Sometimes that's really hard. Being, you know, I have a little boy. If we're doing this as a memory capsule, we should probably go through my family members.
Tell me about Jack.
He's insane and wonderful and quirky, obsessed with dinosaurs. Wants a didgeridoo. Really wants a didgeridoo. He's four. Mm-hmm. And one of the smartest people I know. He makes me feel really quite like I need to go read some more books. He's, yeah, he's definitely got a brain on him. I'm not sure where it came from, but he's special. Yeah. And, you know, you love him.
Of course I love him.
Yeah.
He's the bestest.
He really is. And then Josh, obviously, the American that I married and came over here for. And his family's from the UP. I don't know. I have a very small family unit.
Small and strong.
Yeah. I have a massive extended family, of which I don't see, like, on my parents, like, back in England. I think I'm the only person that's left the I think nobody else has ever gone more than 20 miles from where they were all born. I think I might be the only one that left. My mum's never gonna let me forget that either.
Aww.
But they, you know, they get nice holidays now, right?
Yeah.
They get to come out and visit.
Free place to stay.
Yeah.
It's a bit different.
Huh. I don't know. Yeah, we covered jobs, we've covered family, we've covered quite a lot of my quirky art stuff.
What was the best day of your life?
I can't pick one. I really can't.
Pick a day of your life that you feel made you a little bit of the person you are today.
I can't do that because I think I really feel like experiences, whether good, bad, indifferent, change you every single day. Like, you have obviously things like the day my son was born or the day I got married. They're all amazing events in your life. But I don't know. I feel like every single time you make a decision, it changes you a little bit, and it's all about growing as into, you know, somebody else all the time. I never want to stay the same. Does that count?
Yeah.
I always want to keep, you know, trying to be better. But I can't think of a single. I don't know. There's too many. Climbing Mount Fuji. There's one. That was pretty awesome.
Yeah.
The first time I ever saw my name on film credits and wasn't expecting it in a cinema full of people and my name rolls up on the credits, and that was pretty awesome. That was probably the first time I ever felt that kind of, oh, this is a big deal. Mm-hmm. But it was so, I don't know, because what we do, like, or what you used to do and what I used to do is all these hundreds of thousands of people see it, but you never have that connection because there's always the, mm-hmm. the show in the middle, or the film, or whatever it is you've done. They'll never know. It's just a name on a screen. But for me, that was pretty awesome. What else? I don't know. got too many. I feel really...
I don't think there's such a thing as too many.
You know, I hate the word blessed, like when people go, oh, I feel so blessed.
Yes.
But I really do feel like the best thing I ever did in my life was try, no matter how scary, just to say yes to stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because you just don't know where it's going to end up. Like climbing Mount Fuji because someone thought that was a great idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's really cold and windy up there. I just
seems like it would be.
It's really cold and windy. You know, just saying... I have specific days that I know change the course of my life. Does that count?
If you want them to.
The day I decided with Piglet that I was leaving, that mm-hmm. was a big day. I had, literally, it was a fork in the road. Do I stay in London and do this, or do I take this ridiculous, crazy offer to pack a suitcase and join the circus? And that was a point where I can very definitely say my life could have gone in two very different directions. So... you know, saying yes to stuff is sometimes, I don't know, maybe not the best of ideas.
I don't know. I think you've done all right.
Yeah, what did I do? All of Asia, Canada.
I love how we're doing Asia and Canada.
Right, yeah.
Two very similar sized places.
Right, okay, so where did I go? That might be a really good thing to do if this is going to go as an archive and if I get old and forget all the places I've gone.
Okay, so you started in Atlanta.
Oh, are we doing all the places? Like, should we just say I did North America?
Sure.
Because that was pretty much everything. The whole thing. And Japan, Malaysia, Thailand, Sydney, Melbourne. Where else have I been?
Europe.
All of Europe. It's quite a lot of places.
So if you were looking at this in 10 years' time, what's the one place that you hope that you'll be able to say you've been?
That I haven't been yet?
That you hope that you can have done in the next 10 years.
New Zealand.
Okay.
And Hawaii, because Josh keeps promising me that I can go there, because it's the only place in the US that I didn't get. Oh, and Alaska. I could always do that too.
Okay.
That I'm not
it's
done
good
with.
To have goals.
You know I'm not done with traveling.
Of course you're not.
I can't. It's just my thing. I just... kid in the backpack. Off we go. Yeah.
Do you think you're going to be painting the same stuff in 10 years' time?
No. Come on, no, of course not. I can't, yeah, no. I don't know. It might be of the same vein,
mm-hmm.
but you know, it's just a process, isn't it? This is where I'm at right now, this is what I love to do. I love the idea of going bigger.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be an interesting how you'd get it, because, you know, obviously it's very fluid, so how would you get something like that to, I don't know, that would be... I just keep going bigger. Let's hope I sell a painting and then but do you know the only reason I ever want to sell a painting is so that I can
buy
more paint?
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's the only reason. Because then I can, yeah. So, I don't know. Have we covered most things? Traveling?
Tell me what it means to you to be in ArtPrize this year.
Oh, I don't know. I'll cry.
Well, there's tissues.
I know. It's It's not about the votes, it's not about winning for me, it's not about any of that. It's about really trying to explore now a little bit more of who I am and kind of put myself out there a bit more and just... because it sounds like, on paper, when you look at my life, you go, oh, you did this film and this and you've traveled to all these places and it's all... I felt like I was along for the ride and it's all been amazing, but I've never really had... this is like a really big emotional attachment for me. This is like really trying to find out. Moving to Michigan's been a big learning curve. I feel like I'm settling down a bit more and exploring a bit more. I don't know who I want to be. Quite like my muck boots and my garden and yeah. My apple tree. I have an apple tree now. That's really nice too. Having spent so many, many years living out of a suitcase
mm-hmm.
and not having a home, it's a really nice feeling to think that I don't want to move anywhere for a while. I want to watch Jack grow up in one spot.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good goal. I know. Is that a good place to finish?
If you want it to be.
Yeah, we finished on a life goal, right? Don't move.
Don't move. Good choices.
Yeah. Okay, I think I'm done.
Okay.
Are you done?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm always happy to talk to you.
Well, true. So. I think we're done.